Welcome to the First Principles video and blog series, where we talk about, you know, deep architectural aspects about various OCI products. At OCI, we take a lot of pride in delivering, you know, the maximum performance and the, you know, for the least cost possible and give customers the maximum flexibility possible. Right from the beginning of OCI, we had, you know, bare metal instances and, you know, VM instances as part of our compute product portfolio. And they have essentially been a key part of OCI. Later on, we launched a service called OKE, which is Oracle Kubernetes Engine, which is essentially, you know, manages Kubernetes infrastructure on behalf of customers. And deploys containers, you know, it's very popular these days for cloud native development and such, on top of, you know, OCIs, VMs, and VMs. But today, we actually launched a new product called Container Instances. And to talk about Container Instances and some of the internal aspects of Container Instances, we have with us Sean Osborne, who's essentially a lead architect for, you know, compute infrastructure. Welcome, Sean.
Thanks, Pradeep. Yeah, glad to be here and talk about containers today.
All right, cool. So before we talk about container instances, can you talk a little bit about what is a container, what is a VM, and what are the differences?
Sure, yeah. So we'll start with VMs first, since historically they've been kind of the building block for compute workloads in the cloud, where you have a hypervisor that's running and scheduling multiple VMs on the same server, and then inside that VM, there it has its own guest OS, guest kernel, has dedicated I/O devices like a VNIC to get to virtual networking, a file system on top of a block device for storage,
and then what do you mean by dedicated, you know, network devices?
Oh yeah, so it's the only thing using that device. It's not shared under the hood by anything else. It's just going straight to hardware, and then it's up to the workload inside to run directly on top of that device.
So you're talking about like SRV, you know, virtual functions that are directly exposed directly to
right.
the VM.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
Got it.
Yep.
Okay. And then like for block storage as well, we essentially have, you know, our block storage devices directly exposed.
Yes. Yep. So the customer can, you know, configure it any way they need to, put whatever type of file system they need on it, and then on top of that, deploy their applications, binaries, and libraries. In this model, Oracle manages the hypervisor, the host OS, the kernel, the server, making sure they're configured correctly and performing efficiently, and then also making sure that the VM itself, the underlying infrastructure, the SRV VNIC, that block storage attachment, is plumbed through and given to the VM.
Got it. What else do we have in terms of VMs? What, you know, why else would customers want to use VMs?
Yeah, so some of the main benefits for VMs are really strong security, since there is hypervisor or hardware-based security in the hypervisor for that isolation. And then that dedicated I/O, their workload on those apps is the only thing using those I/O devices. And then also the flexibility. They have direct access to reconfigure the kernel or those I/O devices if they need to tweak it in a special way for their application.
Got it. So essentially what I heard was like, you know, complete isolation from one VM to another.
Mm-hmm.
And then you have, you know, that gives you security boundaries, strong security boundaries from one virtual machine to another. And then you have dedicated, you know, I/O paths. So that provides an additional, you know, dimension of isolation, if you will, particularly from performance standpoint. And then you have extreme flexibility where you can actually, you know, maybe even configure the kernel, pick the modules, whatnot.
Yep.
Got it.
Definitely.
Cool. How about containers then?
So containers, yeah, containers are quickly becoming, you know, a really common way for deploying compute workloads to the cloud. And so wanted to start with the container runtime. So the container runtime manages the kernel for doing kernel-based isolation between the containers. So the containers here, A and B, are running on the same kernel, but they have their own view of the world they're in. Their applications and binaries are isolated from the other container. But that runtime also manages sharing of underlying I/O devices, where typically there's just a single NIC or a single storage device that then needs to be multiplexed across multiple containers running in that environment. The container runtime is usually broken into two parts, an outer runtime, which is pulling the images and setting up the networking and the storage, and then the inner runtime, which is responsible for actually launching that process in Linux with, you know, some namespaces and C groups to isolate it from others.
Got it. So when you say C group isolation, what does that mean? See, is it similar to VM isolation, or is it?
Like, oh, it's different? Quite different. Yeah, it's all software based on, you know, from the kernel itself, which is really C groups are more about controlling how much memory can these processes inside this container start to consume. What CPUs can they run on, and the namespaces, it has its own view of the file system, its own view of the network. So those are the two main mechanisms.
So essentially there's separation between containers and isolation of namespaces and maybe even some aspects of performance, but it's all at the software level.
Right.
As opposed to the VMs, where it's much harder and stricter isolation and done at hardware level.
Right.
Is that right?
Yep.
Cool.
Yep. And then in the container stack, typically, Oracle will manage the server, making sure it's running well. But then all of the software above that still needs to be managed by the customer, including the runtime, the host OS, and the containers themselves.
Got it. What other reasons are there for which customers actually use containers?
Yeah. So a lot of benefits they have. Some being low latency startup time. It's basically as fast as launching a new process. Since the kernel's already running, it's just starting a new process. So you have low latency startup, and then there's a low application developer overhead, kind of a lot of words there, but what that really means is, as an app developer, you just need to focus on patching your application and your binary, and it'll run fine in your container. You don't need to worry about patching and running the rest of the OS and all the other services there. And then lastly, isolation, application isolation, where as an app developer, you just care about what's running in your container. If you update a shared library there, you don't need to worry about it impacting perhaps application running in a different container, because they do have that kernel isolation isolating them.
Got it. So essentially, I think the three advantages of containers, for which many people use containers for, as I heard, is one, it has fast startup time, mm-hmm. which makes all the difference in the cloud world, right? Like, cloud is all about elasticity. And in order to leverage the elasticity provided by cloud, you really need to ramp up resources and ramp down really fast. And containers with a fast ramp up time allows customers to actually ramp up and ramp down fast so that they can elastically use the cloud. Mm-hmm. Right. So that's one of the reasons containers fundamentally better suited for a cloud environment. So that's awesome. And then you mentioned better isolation mm-hmm. at an application level.
Yep.
Right. Where perhaps if it's a microservice, have a service that can comprise of multiple microservices, each one is perhaps a different container.
Right.
Right. Cool.
Yep.
Awesome. All right. So let's talk about container instances. Why this is awesome. There's a bunch of reasons why we do VMs and a bunch of reasons why we do containers. What's this container instances all about?
Yeah. So for container instances, we really did our best to merge together all those benefits from both virtual machines and from containers, and just provide it as a single offering in compute. And so what we've been able to achieve is strong isolation and security boundaries using virtual machines, so that each container runtime is run in a different VM, and a container runtime is dedicated to the customer inside of that VM. And then we also get the other dimension of isolation, which is application. A customer can deploy multiple containers inside that same VM, but they're still containers, so those applications are isolated from one another. And then low startup time. We really focused on optimizing the guest OS and the kernel to start up as fast as possible, to start running those containers as fast as possible. And then manageability. There's a lot of green boxes on here. Oracle is managing a whole bunch of this stack for the end user, from the server all the way up through the container runtime. So the customers only need to worry about the applications and libraries inside their container, and that's it.
Got it. At some level, containers is no different than any other VM in terms of the hardware isolation and the hardware protections that we have, dedicated devices, networking, and block devices. Mm-hmm. So it's a very strong isolation that we traditionally get with VMs. But then we actually go into the stack and we actually manage some of the lower level aspects of the OS inside the the VMs themselves. Mm-hmm. Does that mean that Oracle has control over the guest VMs, or how do you actually manage it?
Yeah, so we have some control over it, in that we have a dedicated channel that has a dedicated REST API that we can communicate over to configure the container runtime, but it's not like we actually have access to inside the environment.
Got it. So essentially, can I SSH? Like, as an Oracle operator, can I actually SSH into this container instance?
No, you can't. You can only go to the proxy, which is running on the hypervisor, and it can communicate through VirtIO VSOC to inside the VM environment.
Got it. So essentially, trying to blend the advantages of both worlds, where you know, we typically don't want to go into customers' environment and have control over it, but we want to help manage that. And this essentially provides that degree of management inside the guest VM where we can perhaps update the operating system, but not necessarily see what's going on inside. You know, we don't have that. So it's essentially, it's, what I heard was like a very thin interface called VSOC. Right. So, and then, you know, we go in and actually update the operating system.
And also via that kind of small interface, VirtIO VSOC is just a well-defined API that you know, that's all we can, we define what can be sent over it, and it's very trimmed down, so that way operators just don't have free reign over inside the VM.
Got it. Now, I see that there are multiple containers within a single container instance. You know, what is the separation? Is that typically like, you know, just like with any other containers, or is it like different?
Yeah, so for multiple containers in the same runtime, they can be configured in a few different ways. Sometimes, you'll want all those containers to be fully isolated, but still in the same runtime, where they can't see the same file system or the same network namespace as others. But then there's the other model, the pod model, where you want...
Pod as in like Kubernetes pods?
Yes, that's exactly.
Quite popular.
Yep.
Got it.
The pod model where the containers will share that same file system and that same networking namespace, which is great for like, that sidecar model where you have a main application container and then a couple other helper containers, maybe one for emitting logs and one for emitting metrics, but you still want them to be able to easily communicate. So you deploy them all as a pod and they can see some level of the same resources and cooperate that way.
Got it, cool. How about the startup time? This actually has a full VM there, like all the network devices. You know, is it as low as like a VM startup or is it as fast as a container startup?
It's much closer to container startup time than VM startup time. So we're in this, you know, single digits of seconds for launching these lightweight VMs and then, you know, instantiating the container runtime versus VMs are usually tens of seconds or more as they have to discover a whole bunch of services, do DHCP and things like that, and then also just contain a whole bunch of libraries and other services that we eliminated out of the lightweight VM.
Got it. So essentially, it's like ones of seconds of startup time for container instances, as opposed to a traditional VM, which could be in tens of seconds. How do we achieve that?
Yeah, so first, stripped out over 70% of the libraries.
70%? Nobody needed those 70%?
Well, not for running containers. So we really took a close look at what exactly is needed to run a container. And then if it wasn't needed, we took it out. Things like Python was taken out, Perl, libstandard, C++, just a whole bunch of libraries and utilities that most people would expect in a general purpose operating system. But since we just care about containers, it was if container D or run C doesn't need it, we take it out.
Got it. So we essentially strip down the operating system to just what's needed to launch, you know, the container runtime effectively, right?
Yep.
Like, well, on the other hand, if an app needs like Python, let's say, it's actually going to be, you know, packaged as part of the container.
Right. Exactly.
Got it. Cool. So that's pretty cool. But how about like, you know, if the typically when a kernel comes up, it's actually going to start scanning devices and, you know, stuff like that. Does it do all of that here? Like, you know, how does it work?
So
because they can actually add to the startup time.
Yeah, it really can. Yeah, if it's doing like a PCI bus probe or something like that. Yeah, so we have everything statically configured, so it doesn't need to enumerate. So that saves a lot of time, and we've also reduced the number of devices the VMCs to begin with. So that also cuts down on time quite a bit.
Got it. Cool. So when you said, you know, 70% cut down a very, you know, stripped down operating system, it reminds you of, you know, some of the open source initiatives or perhaps, you know, some of the initiatives, you know, are sponsored by, you know, other cloud providers, Kata containers or Firecrackers. So is this actually, you know, similar to that or is this different?
It's similar in that it's achieving the same goals as far as hardware-based security to isolate these containers. But we did, we took a look at both of them to see, you know, if either one would work for us. And for us, we decided to go with Qemu KVM for our virtual machine manager. One of the reasons being Oracle Linux has had, you know, good ties, strong ties with that community for many years now. And we're very familiar with the code space there. And also, we took the approach of trying to just narrow down the code space there rather than build something from new up and then always having to be adding things. A good example there might be Firecracker today doesn't have a PCI bus, and they have reasons for that. They wanted to reduce code, but we think we're going to be needing the PCI bus sooner rather than later for things like GPUs and NVMEs inside a container. So Kimi KVM is a great fit for that. So we just had more control of our own destiny there in Kimi KVM. And then for Kata, we really tried to make it work. We spent a long time analyzing that. But Kata, as I talked about earlier, there's that outer runtime and that inner runtime. And Kata, the outer runtime runs on the host side. And then the inner runtime is inside the VM. And so that means anytime you're trying to attach a resource, you've got to connect that customer resource to the host OS and then plumb it up through, via Kata shim into the inner runtime. And we found that kind of cumbersome to deal with since Kata didn't natively know how to attach OCI resources. And then also some isolation concerns there where we're attaching customer resources directly to a hypervisor is not the most secure pattern. So that's why we went with Kimi KVM with the entire container runtime inside that guest OS and inside that virtual machine.
Got it. So essentially, we wanted the flexibility to have, PCI attached devices and, container instances. Mm-hmm. That was a key deciding factor. In addition, from a security standpoint, obviously when you have, any type of customer agent or customer facing, interface, or entities running, mm-hmm. or devices running, we obviously want to have that within the boundary of customers' VM,
yep.
So that if there's any breakout, it actually happens within, that's always the security best practice. And, what I'm hearing is that, we really wanted to have this container runtime inside the guest VM or the mm-hmm. container instance, if you will. And that was, and in some of the, perhaps in Kata, some of these actually lie outside.
Right. Yep.
Got it. Cool. That is a really good reason to actually, go with this approach.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Cool. Awesome. So the other thing that's actually unique about, container instances, I've noticed, is that, obviously Kubernetes is a very established, orchestration mechanism for containers, mm-hmm. and it's very popular. And in fact, we are completely aligned with that, and with OKE, with the Oracle Kubernetes Engine, we have a really popular managed container offering. And I can imagine container instances is obviously a great fit as a backend for OKE, mm-hmm. and that is actually part of our strategy. But then in addition to that, we also chose to launch container instance as a standalone OCI product.
Yeah.
Why is that?
Yeah, Kubernetes is great as a that container orchestrator, but we thought there was still a market or a need for being able to launch just simple container instances where maybe you don't have a microservice-based architecture that maps well to Kubernetes. You just want to launch a few instances, maybe behind a load balancer, and just really worry about that application code and not the rest of the VM. So that's why you're on container instances, but you don't need to scale out the way Kubernetes does. And then along those lines too, Kubernetes, there's a bit of a learning curve there, learning what replica sets are, scheduling policies, kind of some sharp points on the edges where you can cut yourself with. So with container instances, it's just a good way to start to adopt container-based architecture. And then lastly, there's cases where it's a very large application that maybe hasn't, they want to get to Kubernetes someday, but they haven't gone through breaking themselves up into a microservice-based architecture, so they can just lift and shift from a VM to inside a container, and then from there evolve to Kubernetes.
Got it. So it essentially offers customers more flexibility than mm-hmm. we would otherwise.
Yep.
If customers just want to, have few container instances that directly manage, they can do that without incurring the overhead of having Kubernetes in the middle. Maybe they actually have their own orchestration mechanism. So it essentially offers, additional flexibility.
Yep.
For that type of, perhaps simple use case or maybe a customized use case where, they want to have their own thing.
Yep.
Got it. Cool. Sounds good. Well, thank you for joining us today, Sean.
Yeah, thanks for having me.
And thank you for tuning in today.